All right, we're back. Hello, and I guess I didn't get a response from the admin. So what we believe, and we're going to cross our fingers and hope is going to be the case, is that after this, Gung Fu Panda and TLO will play with their match being held. But we don't actually know if that's going to be the case or not. For now, though, we are in the lobby for Sasuke versus Primelot. It is going to be a PvP, so I'm glad I got the guy right for once. I was just going to mention, though, about the camera thing again, because I know I'm going to have to constantly bring this up over time, but my webcam straight up broken, guys. Like, this is not a lack of confidence thing. It's not a feeling shy or I'm not sick. I just, my camera literally doesn't work. Like, it's on right now. Like, if I could take a picture with my phone camera and tweet it to make you believe me, like, you can see the blue lights on it showing up. Like, the camera is on, but it's not picking up any video or feeding anything into the computer. So, my thoughts are, I either have to try and find this small, tiny-ass screwdriver to unscrew it and potentially re-solder the wiring inside, which I don't mind doing. I've done that before to fix microphones and stuff. It's not hard. Just Google, like, how to. But if that doesn't work, then I'll just have to buy a new one. And buying a new one consists of leaving the house. And that, my friends, is the real challenge.
Finally found the real issue here.
I mean, on one hand, there's sun outside. On the other, then I have to take a bus, get to Best Buy. Ugh, deal with the people at Best Buy. Ugh. Take a bus back home? Another bus? Ugh! Like, just tell me that doesn't sound like an unappealing day. Damn.
It does. What are these... I keep... Since I imagine you so out in, like, the neck of the woods, are these buses, like, you get on Greyhound buses and take a two-hour trip?
It's not that bad, okay? Admittedly, I've got it bad, but it's not that bad. The only problem with the buses is the consistency is really off. Like... Mm. You'll go to take the bus, and you're like, great, okay, I showed up 20 minutes ahead of time, my bus should be here. But turns out 20 minutes ahead of time is actually 20 minutes that it's running late, so you actually still have to wait there an hour anyways, because they only run once every hour, whereas in the city, they run every, like, 15 minutes to 30 minutes. God, when I go to the city, yeah. It's like a wonderland. I'm like, oh, look at all these buses sprinkled here, sprinkled there, there's buses everywhere!
I was going to say, that sounds about right, because I don't live, like, out in the boonies or anything, but I used to before everything got developed here, so the bus schedule still isn't really good, and my friend used to have to take it to go to work or the mall.
I love, by the way, that the boonies is, like, a universal term here, where I'm pretty sure a lot of people will know what I'm talking about. It's not one section of land that any one person is, like, familiar with.
Yeah. But the city is so much better.
Abso-freaking-lutely. That's also, like, way more expensive, but that's a whole nother can of worms right there. Either way, it looks like they're saying Lambo will be next, or what?
Well, one of the casters wants to take that. But I don't know if... I don't know. Yeah, because TLO Gung Fu should definitely be, you know...
TLO Gung Fu is, like, the best matchup, not just in terms of, like, skill versus skill or name versus name or anything like that, but they are literally the, I think, best matched up set for this round. Yeah. Not to take shots fired at anyone else here. I don't think anyone's, like, super bad or anything. German qualifiers is always the best because they've had the whole, oh gosh, I can't remember, the Meisterkraft. I can never pronounce that correctly, but LAN EPS, or no. What was that thing they would always mock Hashops for? EPS champion.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, they've had a lot of specifically German-on-German stuff before. So, none of these guys are unfamiliar with one another. And these are, like, typically what you'd see over there.
Mm-hmm. Well, we didn't get a response, so...
Cool, yeah. The admin just left instead of responding. Feels bad. I don't know what the hell that means, but... Alright, guys, we'll do what we can. Getting into a brand new series, though, it is going to be a PvP where they have picked similar colors on a very blue map. Super grateful this happened, but that's okay. We'll try and guide you through it the best we can. Spawning here on the upper left side of the map, it's going to be the blue Protoss Primelot. Sounds like a Transformer.
It does. In the bottom right, as the teal Protoss is. Okay.
Primelot, transform and roll out.
Thanks to Haleon, we didn't get that.
16 months late. Oh, why did Twitch Alerts disconnect me? I gotta connect it now?
There you go.
Alright. Hopefully that fixes things. I was just going to mention, though, I think Sake, I got to give my favoritism to here. We got to see some pretty good games out of him more recently. He's been playing in, frankly, like a little bit here and a little bit there. It's just more and more frequent out of a player I thought was completely retired and done with StarCraft. So really excited to see him playing again.
Yeah, me too. I feel like he's really been getting back into form, too. This isn't a case of he shows up and then he just consistently always disappoints. Like, he has some really nice games.
Just showing, by the way, how universal poops can be. The poop emoji. Same thought process out of the French casters as I couldn't verbalize it in French. They might not be able to verbalize it in English, but with one simple emoticon, we describe that it's total balls that these guys are the same color.
Basically. It's really, I feel like it's not so bad. I mean, for some people it will be. But luckily blue is pretty dark blue here. Teal is pretty teal.
True enough. By the way, just one last topic on the whole webcam thing. I know I was making a joke of a story about this crazy adventure that I'd have to go on. I could just simply order it off Amazon. I'm fully aware, guys. But I'd rather fix the one I have than spend like $80 to $100 on a new web camera, if possible. It's not even being frugal either, I'd love to admit, but I'm just like this really smart, savvy saver. It's about stubbornness. I'm like, no. No, I know you still work. Like, I could fix you.
Don't die on me. Yeah. Yo.
Boom, boom, boom. There's, he's coding.
All right, I see double adept openers, what I was going for, and then a Stargate splendid down by Zake. So we'll see what Prime Lot follows up with. He's immediately following up with two Stalkers, so I love it's a little bit faster.
What I think is kind of cool about this at Asake, and that's why I really enjoy the potential what Stargate openers bring to the party, is like, okay, you've got the adepts cancel each other out more or less, right? Ideally, you'll both have Stalkers, you both have adepts, and no one should get their mineral line compromised. But even with two Stalkers defending, an Oracle can get in there and do some very, very serious damage.
Mm-hmm. Alright, I thought it was going to be a Nexus for Prime Lot, and it is. But, you know, the biggest difference is that Zaka is able to kind of squeeze in the Stargates. Is this probe really going to get in there and scout?
Nope.
Okay, there's a Stalker there. Good, because this can be a very big surprise. It's not an Oracle, so it won't be like instant death, 6, 10 probes or whatever, but to bulk up Phoenix without being scouted, that did actually still get like 6 probe kills if the army's out of position, because, you know, it's not worried about being in the mineral line. It figures it's a normal game. I think all Prime Lot saw was that the Nexus was, I don't think he saw that it was like a second or two later, because it really is, what, 15 seconds later? Not even. 4.
Well, pile on to fully wall this out. No adept transfer getting through to the main anytime soon. With no probes being transferred down, it's not so bad. Cancels it, though. A big part of this really is Sake not wanting to have had his Stargate scouted. I mean, we'll get Primeless Vision. No idea that it's down. And he's bulking up Phoenix instead of rushing across the map with an Oracle. This is going to be such a surprise hitter. The Prime Lot, who's probably going to match Zaki in terms of gateway production, right? Like, they're going to have similar gateway units, but Prime Lot will have a couple more. At the end of the day, I think 5 Phoenixes lifting anything in this air is going to be superior. Hell, especially if it comes down to immortal fights. You lift that immortal in the sky, and that just takes up such a big portion of your army. Such a hard-hitting unit.
Yeah. The only thing that could tell Prime Lot there's something up would be that there was one less Stalker than what he got, which is, I guess, suspicious if you think they're really going for the exact same build. And of course, the sentries now, that would be a big difference too. But the adept, that was the last scouting he had, it's died now. He does have units in his natural mineral line, and I feel like this is just, it's good practice no matter what you think's happening in the PvP, but those Phoenix run right into everything. Lose one, and I wonder, especially since he only went for 3 Phoenix, like, even with a surprise 3 Phoenix, those are only going to get, I would say, max 6 probe kills on undefended mineral line.
Yeah, I really thought
if he had waited for a lot more, they could have, like, totally wrecked it.
Right, I really thought that was going to go up to 5 or so. Also, just quick apology for that small audio blip just now, guys. I meant to mute myself while coughing, and I accidentally muted all sounds for 1 second. But, anyways, the Phoenix, it felt almost a little bit greedy to go that early. I understand the necessity of wanting to get probe kills with also understanding how hard it is to catch Phoenix, but yo, Prime Lot was ready to go, man. That was just bad. Yeah. Almost was another one, but the overcharge will chase it off. War Prism at the top right might accidentally get scouted if Sake were to come home. Yeah. But unfortunately, looks like won't be the case. And if that's going to be the situation, Prime Lot's going to have no problem picking off probes in that main.
Ozaki does have a lot of energy on that mothership, and the pylons are pretty well positioned. And I was gonna say, that's the one thing the Phoenixes are doing, is taking away all the energy from the mothership core, but Ozaki's not really following up with, like, this huge push or anything like that, so it's... I don't think that's that important.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, it
doesn't... Primelight just got better, I think, on the overall game here. Faster plus one, faster immortal production. It's slower in the Rhythmic Blades, I guess.
I have been playing too much co-op with Alarak. I was like, why didn't he just overcharge his gateways? Why did he overcharge the pylon?
Silly. Yeah.
Yo, actually, I was playing a co-op mission last night, leveling up Alarak, and Kerrigan was putting those Omega Worms all over the place. The Nidus Worms, sorry for those who don't use co-op. And you can overcharge those, apparently. So, she would just... We would literally unload our whole army in a second while having a photon overcharge Nidus Worm on Burrow. It was pretty much the most disgusting combination of attacks I've seen yet.
Amazing. Well, co-op has ruined my Protoss. I don't bother putting pylons in correct positions anymore.
Right? You're just like, these are just supply. Who cares about them anymore? I can't.
Yeah. The Phoenix is, as, you know, kind of bad as they were for Zake, it didn't really affect him drastically on the overall. Again, he is, like, a little behind on a couple of different areas, like the plus one and the third base is now a little bit behind. He actually caught up in Immortals because Primelot stopped making them, which is interesting, but... I guess they're both going into Temple Archives now. Okay, Primelot goes back into Immortal production. And they both went for Resonating Glaives. They're going to get a lot of Adepts, and it is kind of like a question of, like, how effective are Immortals going to be when no one is going for those Stalkers, but... It's still, they're still units. They like the Archons more.
They're people too.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Alright, Warpers is coming in for round two. This time the Phoenix are on top of it, so won't be able to see a total dedication.
Not even letting them down? Alright.
Feels bad, man.
Yeah. I guess Primelot didn't mean to go for that Dark Shrine. I could have sworn it was about 30 seconds in, at least, when I saw it and I didn't see it get cancelled. But he might have meant to make a Temple Archives. Or maybe he just decided not to go for it because he knew Phoenixes are out. I'm not entirely sure, but Deathly doesn't have one now. So I guess the Warp Prism wasn't going to be super effective, but it still would have been nicer to get those Adepts out.
Speaking of Warp Prisms.
Oh, that Warp Prism.
Yeah, dancing around up here.
Whoa,
sorry.
Whoa.
Well, both players goofing that up pretty bad. I was going to just comment, though, first off, sorry I missed that, because, again, the map, the colors, whatever, I'm not going to make excuses, just explaining reasoning. But, secondly, the Templar Archives getting revealed is one thing, you're already thinking Archons, but the fact that he saw this being chronoed, the fact that he knew this was researching Storm, I'm wondering how much that changes his thought process on the game. Because on one hand, Storm is kind of really, it's questionable for engagements, right? Like, Protoss units are actually all robust enough to not necessarily care too much about Storm. But your mineral lines are still pretty big weaknesses, and we've seen really cool PvP storm drops out of players like Puck and others that have straight up destroyed people.
Yeah. I do wonder, you know, we've seen that as the only purpose for getting Storm, for sure, and then the rest of the game is normal and they don't really ever use it versus the army. But I do wonder if Primelot intends to use it on the army first and Storm drops second for once. He's keeping all the high tempos with his army, he's not, you know, putting them into Archons. And I'm just thinking, you know, Adept versus Adept, and they both recognize that was the case, of course. And they both intentionally went for plus two before Primelot went for the plus one armor, because it's the important upgrade for, you know, letting the Adepts, what, two-shot each other? But anyways, if you can storm a mass amount of Adepts, because they clump, you know, it's not as effective as a disruptor shot on them, but it is a lot of damage.
Certainly, yeah. It's, I guess, the idea is that storms can reach, too. Archons, for example, they've got a lot of splash, but they got to be right up in your face. Storms do have a bit of range, though.
Versus light. Six. No, they didn't four-shot them. Three-shot. Anyway, the math is there. I'm not going to do it. Point is, they both have plus two now, except that Primelot's about to have plus one. There are the Storms in the army, and whether he's looking for the Adepts or not, Storm is general AoE damage. It's nice to have.
And it does take a considerable amount of shields on the Adepts. Zaki's actually going to transfer through and take the fight. I don't know about this. A little bit too close to call it. A little bit too colorful for me to differentiate, but it does look like Primelot takes the better engagement. And I think a lot of that had to do with losing. Like, Zaki just lost all the Adepts right away. No shields going into that transfer. Already AoE down. Now what's left should be able to clean up Zaki's Immortals, and rebuilding this army will be too slow and take too long. Like, this was a really one-sided fight. funny enough, there's like no anti-air left over though, so the phoenixes are also left somewhat alive. I don't know. Saki's gonna try and resupply his army, but I mean, you consider both these players are on equal income. Primelot has better upgrades, and he's going into this with an army that did not die. Saki should not really be able to bridge this gap unless they both wait till they're like 200-200 to push.
Yeah, that fight certainly went a lot better for Primelot. Very interested in the storm thing. Not seen it before, and it's, you know, partially because we don't have a lot of PvPs, but...
I don't think it was terrible at all, but it was interesting watching Saki dedicate instead of walk away from that fight.
Like, I really thought he saw, like, twice? Wow, there's, like, four I Templars that are going to be sniped by my Adepts before they can turn to Archons, and if he storms his own army, that's still beneficial for me. It doesn't really work out that way.
Well, either way, we got the attack commencing on a prime lock. Comes in with a big army supply lead. Those overcharges can help a ton, but the pylons go down pretty darn quick. The Immortals on the backside also remaining untouched. No barriers being triggered, no shields being taken down, and it looks like the Archons are more than enough to win this game. GG, Primelot takes game number one.
Yep.
Good also, stuff. A little surprising, because again, I really thought this would have been a very Sake-sided series. Okay, So I've been confirmed with the admin now that TLO Gung Fu Banda is next, then Lambo versus Fear.
And is that it?
I believe so, but I also have no way to confirm that.
Okie dokie. Let's recall Skype.
Oh, love when this happens. Alright guys, we'll get this next game, we'll get this sorted, we'll see you guys soon. Alright folks, we should have the audio colors fixed, hopefully. Audio colors? Did I just say that right? The audio problems fixed, hopefully. I was reading Damaga talk about the player colors as I was speaking, so that was an interesting little gaffe. But, yeah, they're basically trying to make them go red and blue to avoid the color issue of the previous game.
Yeah. That was pretty brutal. With the Archons, especially.
Yeah. I was like, I'm pretty sure that the blue guy's winning. And I wasn't incorrect, necessarily.
You weren't. Oh, God. Keep forgetting there's, like, a task view button. Windows. I press it occasionally.
Task view?
It's right next to your folder icon on the bar, in the menu bar.
Oh, that thing, yeah.
Three little things, yeah.
Three little things.
Never used it on purpose.
Alright, well folks, we're back. Game number two, and in the bottom left side, he is currently leading 1-0 in this PvP. It's going to be the Red Protoss Primelot.
In the bottom right, as the blue Protoss, he's Zake.
Oh man, I don't know how. I'm sure I'm not the first person to make this joke, but after reading it in chat, if Artosis was an animal, you know what type of animal he'd be?
What's that?
An Artortus. An Artostis. Whatever. I'm misreading it. Someone wrote that in chat, though. Oh. So, well played. Well done.
I think that was clever.
There's nothing that really works for our names, like, even my real name doesn't fit to be like an animal pun. Graham. Ugh.
Yeah, it is Jessica.
Oh my god, no, I take it back. I could be a grandimal? Graminal? Whatever. No, I ruined it. Forget it. Shouldn't have tried. One of those thoughts that should have just stayed in my head. Alright, probably gonna get some scouting with the pro really early. Sake, not so much. But the double gateway opener is already kind of... It's on one hand, it is revealing, but it's revealing of a pretty normal opening nowadays. I think we saw Legacy start, and even for the first several months into it, seeing two gateways was so abnormal, you're like, whoa, buddy, what are you doing? But this really has changed to be the standard.
Yeah, yeah. It seems like every opener revolves around it, so... Well, last time they opened up with Adepts, both then Stalkers, and then Zaki went to that Stargate that really didn't add much to his build, I would say. It gave him... There's a couple of important things it gave him, and when you consider what he gave up for it, which was a Stalker and, you know, a couple extra minerals, it wasn't so bad, but, you know, he did invest in the three Phoenix that only gave him map control, and that's kind of, like, too strong of a word. They gave him map presence. He was able to scout on the map and feel at least a little bit comfortable, but they didn't do much besides that. And I don't think that would have changed the course of battle, but certainly the actual engagement could have been done better too. Yeah, common location for a proxy. Just what type of proxy is it going to be?
The fact that he's potentially proxying at all, I do find a little bit surprising. I don't feel like that game that he just played against Sokka was so determinably one-sided that you're like, oh man, this guy's going to be easy and like risk something like a proxy. But at the same time, it may also just be that element of surprise and Sokka wouldn't see it coming. Either way, for him, he is pumping out a couple more Stalkers and he's heading across the map with his own probe, which he may be just placing a pylon down for. Mothership, of course, is going to see this probe and should be able to take care of it, so no pesky pylons over here. And
no tricks.
Where does this go? Does this just go straight to the mineral line? What's he planning to do with this?
Scout? I don't know. This is, I don't know. It's up to Sokka actually now to actually do some damage here. Of course, Primal tries to put a pylon down.
He almost got it.
He did almost get it. That was surprising, but with only two Stalkers, it shouldn't be four Stalkers.
Well, it's
going
to be four, and this is a fight he can take. He was trying to get the pylon so there wouldn't be an overcharge, of course, but hell, just forcing the overcharge and backing away from time being is not too bad. Maintains a little bit of high ground vision, almost gets the Mothership core. A little bit scary and a little bit spicy, but Saki's left with enough Stalkers alive that the second this runs out, he can easily pressure in again.
Yeah. I like the addition of two pylon if he can afford it, which he could. So that one's definitely going to go down, and one more will probably go down. But as long as one finishes, that's going to be just enough. He does have one overcharge left over. Oh, but now he has to worry about the Adept Shades getting in here.
Even though the overcharge pops, he does walk away from it pretty easily. The Adepts do transfer through to the main. This drives all the Stalkers back here to stop them from killing the probes, but in the process, forces him to give up the natural. While this goes on, Sokka, of course, is setting up his own natural base, but he's up like 8 workers for it. Not getting a lot of kills. 2 probe kills went down. Not that many probe kills, but still, he's up quite a bit of workers.
Yeah. And there are certainly times where Primelot was not building probes or intentionally didn't, as he needed a couple of pylons. So that is a pretty big deal. He does have an overwhelming force now and pushes Zaki back, but there's not much counter aggression he can do, knowing that Zaki probably has his own Mothership core and his own pylons already set up and ready to go.
Well, a little bit scary as the Stalkers give chase and Zaki is too weak to actually fight, but falling back to the main looks like it's totally doable. The Stalkers even regenerating shields. Happens if you're 10 seconds out of combat. So with his own overcharge and a couple of warped in units, there's just no way that Primelot can push into this. Not with what he has.
Mm-hmm. Well, now it's taking a loss. Down 5 probes. Gonna try and maybe help that out with a warp prism drop. But of course, Zaki's thinking the same thing. And Zaki's the one that's already on his way to Rhythm and Glaives and +1. So that's actually pretty brutal. Primelot's really fallen behind in the tech war, only just now putting down his Twilight Council.
Well, in regards to the follow-up to this, Saki's aggression did net him a little bit more income later at the sacrifice of a little bit early on. And I really wish we did have the income graphs available to show that. Quick shout-outs to Durlino for the 28 months. This hasn't been 28 months already. Jeez. Well, here's to another 28. Sir, cheers to you! Another! But my point of this income thing was this game, while still determinedly a little bit better for Sokka, should be more or less evened up. I wish he had one Sokka in this War Prism. He could have unloaded here and chased off Primelots so easily, but a little bit tentative because he saw it late. He knows this is here, and Stalkers are repositioned in the main, ready to intercept. But another pylon gets set up over here on a Primelot. Looks like he will have another warping location to potentially use. Either way, Sokka heading over the main will likely not get much done, but Primelot also is not getting much done either.
A little bit awkward of a, just not even a stalemate, just not doing much lately.
It's the normal standoff.
Yeah.
You don't have normal standoffs too often.
Coincidentally, Scout's that. This proxy pylon, it could be used to double attack for sure, and it's probably what Primelot wanted to do, but with Saki's army moving out, he would be advised to warp in anywhere but at home. Couple of Adepts get more probe kills, and Sokka could hit Primelot before he has any upgrades whatsoever.
I mean, Saki's coming in with +1 with better units. He's going to be a little bit busy in the main chasing off this warp prism, but he does it pretty well and doesn't lose anything for it. Now that he's ready to go, this Adept army should be able to win out. I mean, 12 Adepts to 4. I think at the end of the day, we all know Adepts beat everything else. It's all about the Adept versus the Adept War, and with that +1 benefiting him so heavily, Focusing down units won't be too much of a problem. Kills that pylon, no overcharge. He tried for it, but he's just gonna leave. Oh shit. Alright, well, game goes to Sake and he now ties it up 1-1.
Yeah. I think that was more of a leave of like, I played badly than it was like, I shouldn't have lost this. Like, he did mess up in a couple of different points. I don't know.
Maybe it was a giant rage quit. Maybe just a big baby zombie. Have you ever considered that?
I have no idea.
How dare you not just assume that this guy is bad? Mad because bad. Oh. No, I really don't think this was anything too big. But give me 1 second. This game. Okay, sorry about that, guys. Anyways, unfortunately, as we said, we don't quite have control over the games as per usual, but just a reminder that we should be getting to TLO Gungfu Banda after this next game, after this final match between Sake and Primelot. And that one I'm really looking forward to. I also think Lambo Fear is going to be great. Like, we had two really good ZVPs lined up.
Yeah. No Terrans. It's fine.
Well, I know Hiro Marine was playing on the bottom side of the bracket. I hope we see him play tomorrow, at least. He should get through.
Yeah, we should.
He plays the winner of Primelot versus Sake.
Yeah.
TVP. Germans, where all the Protoss are, apparently. Germany. Excuse me.
Sounds about right. That sounds correct. I mean, I know what you think about TLO, I guess. You think about Germans, but I think once upon a time, it was all Protoss. Also known for Protoss.
Well, whether you're a Protoss fan or otherwise, I don't think any part of the game, despite balance for the moment, like whatever statistically is the truth of balance, I don't think anything's as tilting to play as Legacy of the Void Protoss.
To play as?
At least from watching other streamers, from hearing what everyone has to say, like nobody seems to really thoroughly enjoy it. Maybe the exception of like Neeb and a couple others.
That's interesting.
Like, you listen to a lot of the way Drogo was talking when he was streaming a lot. You listen to some of the interviews that were written. Like, a lot of them talk about how they hate that they have to all in, or they don't like the way adepts are, like, technically designed. And I don't know. Like, it doesn't. Maybe this is just my perspective. I want to put that out there, guys. I'm not trying to say that this is the statement of all Protoss, but it just feels like the majority of the ones I've spoken to and seen things written from have not really enjoyed the design of units in Legacy. Compared to, I guess, the enjoyment that they had winning a bunch in HOTS?
I have some comments about that. Let's do the intros first.
All right, spawn the top left side. It's going to be the red Protoss, Primelot.
In the bottom left, as the blue Protoss, he is Sake. And it's funny to hear that. Like, I can understand it because Terrans will have the same thing occasionally. Like, they'll be like, I hate that I have to go to live for Liberators, but it's the only thing that can work against Ultralisk. It's the only thing that can work against, you know, post-10-minute TVP, but they're badly designed units. So I certainly know that there's a lot of grumbles about the Adept as a dependent unit. Like, you depend too much on it. It's almost the replacement Colossus, because that used to be the complaint in Heart of the Swarm, was that, oh, I hate that I have to depend on a death ball. You know, that's how Protoss is designed. Or I hate that I have to two base all in, but that's how Protoss is designed.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay. Like, I know both arguments are valid, but I also know that Legacy of the Void is far more enjoyable game to watch from Protoss. And in my opinion, play from Protoss, because I play it so often. But I just find it a lot more fun. And I don't know. It's, of course, personal preference and whatnot. And you can always have complaints about the game, but I thought it was going to be along the lines just that it's changed so much, because that's always been something I've been very sympathetic with Protoss. Terran has really not changed drastically from expansion to expansion. Our compositions have messed up a little bit. First it was tanks, then it was one of mines, and then maybe it's not tanks again, who knows, but Protoss drastically changed. And I still feel for the Protosses who feel stuck with their race, because that's the one they practice for so long, when actually it's, you know, in a lot of ways, it's a completely different race and playstyle.
I'm a little bit sad that is the case for a couple of different reasons, but regardless, I'm just glad to see that the good players that are still here have managed to adapt. Again, things like the two-gate opener versus two-gate opener are a lot more standard and a lot less game over. It's almost it's not everyone whines about the race. Everyone balance complains that, you know, they're not the best, but at the end of the day, it's nice to see the players that stuck through are still playing the game well enough that you're not like, wow, meow.
Yeah. Well, Primelot, we thought you wanted to do something last game, and then just, you know, Probus went off and did whatever. So now doing it here goes for the Stargates, but oh my god. Zage, he feels like something's up. He's looking, and he's gonna find it. I mean, unfortunately, you can't, like, kill the building SCV, right? But
well,
can you kill the pilot?
Maybe one, but not two. I was just gonna point out that this actually is not so weird when you consider last game he was scouting around and found a little probe waiting for proxies. So he may have thought very well that Primelot had this on his mind. The Stalkers can certainly kill us though, so cancels the Stargate. Smart move out of Primelot because there was no way he was going to get this up at this point. Meanwhile, two Adepts do make it through to the main and they're going to get a couple of probe kills, maybe up to even four or five depending. Stalkers are taking a long time to clean them up.
Well, I just almost crashed out of StarCraft.
No, that feels weird. Bad, man.
Weird. Hopefully it fixes itself. It's not like any storms around or anything. Well,
a proxy of his own. Yeah, a proxy of his own flavor and variety. And this one's actually going to be for gateways. So just warping in lots of adepts and things across the map quickly. It's not exactly a warp prism, but it'll get the job done in a pinch.
Yeah, yeah. Primelot's going to be going for an oracle from his own base. So it sucks it's a little bit delayed and then further delayed, of course, because it's not a proxy, but. The question is, can it deal damage to make up for the fact that it's, you know, it's not an extra stalker helping defend right now? That's...
Yeah, a little bit awkward to watch. Meanwhile, the fight in the front doesn't go so well, and only just barely doesn't go well thanks to the Mothership Corps has to walk away from this with a lot of very injured stalkers now. They can't necessarily reinforce from up here because he doesn't want to give this away just yet.
Yeah, that didn't go nearly as good as that last game, where he really caught Primelot just a little bit off guard. So this Oracle is going to, it doesn't matter that it wasn't back at home defending. It is going to, I think, do some damage here. The Mothership Corps is actually, I don't know why I said it in the natural. You see a Mothership Corps like that, I'm surprised he didn't just go straight for the main.
Right?
He does miss the timing, though. Like, there was a pylon right there, so even though he tried to,
It's part of the reason why big fight potentially going down outside of his main or natural. Either way, Stalker for Stalker, Primelot looks like not too bad in terms of having the numbers for this for now, combined with another overcharge here or there, but I don't know. Saki's looking to really lay the pressure on thick. Winning this first fight just barely. Oracle comes in to help a little bit. Kites back for it. Almost kills it. Stalker to Stalker, 7-5. Saki still has a small lead. As Warpin should be in his favor, but he's a little bit shy on money, losing some of those probes, not getting the money in the natural like he wanted to. So, finding it a little bit hard to get the numbers game overwhelming.
Yeah. I mean, Primal's having trouble with his gas. He just spent 100 on a mothership, so he can only warp in one stalker. But I think he has enough, especially with that overcharge. And if he has enough for this, then Zaki might just... Well, yeah, he's over-dedicating, and he's losing the game from this, even though his economy isn't terrible. If he loses all the army, if it truly snowballs...
But if Primelot gets baited to high ground, that's where Saki takes advantage, kills the Stalkers, and brings this back to a fighting position.
Nice target fire on that last one, but same for Primelot. At least when he did react, he focus-fired the weak Stalkers, so... And it's some nice micro back and forth, a few mistakes back and forth as well, but... The Oracle's still alive, trying to come back in, get two more probes, and this is just adding on, you know, piece by piece. Primelot is getting an advantage. And his Mothership Corps is just getting more energy, too. Like, I can't actually see Zaki breaking Primelot. I can see him taking decent trade, by letting the Stalkers chase him, but...
If he baits him away, yeah. Like, if Primelot chases and Zaki can win by going up high grounds, getting warp-ins, then, yeah, he'll come back and overwhelm. But Primelot's playing it pretty smart by staying back, fighting within the range of the overcharge, not overextending, even canceling that potentially just weak point of the pylon.
Yeah, at this point really is useless. He knows where the gateway is, by the way, too, now. So he knows that chasing this way is not as problematic.
Yeah, it's not nearly as dangerous.
Pulling back. His Oracle's still looking for damage done. He's actually setting up a proxy pylon that will provide slow warp-ins, but still, even one adept plus the Oracles in both mineral lines, that's something that Zaki actually can't defend against.
I think Zaki's just straight up lost it at this point, and lag hits for
Gaming! Ah! Woo!
Primelot's particularly salty about this because he thinks he's perhaps in a dire position, but it is worth noting Primelot is actually going to win this game at this rate. Saki's behind by about 10 workers. There's enough stalkers in that front line to hold. I mean, admittedly and deservedly, he's a bit pissed about the lag out timing, but unfortunately, this is not always something you have control over, so hopefully old gaming can fix their connection and this won't cause too many issues going forward.
Mm-hmm. Well,
that being said, I feel like there's not a lot to analyze here because every single thing we can see at the moment, resources lost, army supply, probe count, money in the bank, it all points towards Primelot. There's not a single point of advantage that really leans Sake's way.
Yeah, and he's, I think, starting to get desperate, too. Like, he's probably realized the situation for a while now. Oh, okay, well, sucks he loses the mothership core like that. But he might be thinking about a Dark Shrine with his Twilight Council. He might be able to get just a straight-up upgrade, you know, Blink, for instance, because he has so many stalkers. But I don't think that's enough to come back, just to have that one addition to your army over them. And Primelot's even going for Immortals now. So even if Sake eventually got to Blink, Primelot would have like two Immortals by
now. Ooh, but Force Fields are a nice way to get on the top with these Stalkers. And until those Immortals out, the time still ticks. But looks like, even with those slick moves, Primelot's not hurting too bad for it.
He should be a little bit more scared because the Mothership Core did die, but I really think that he would have Defender's Advantage. I mean, at worst, you pull the probes and you lose about 9, but you still survive, and that's fine. And you'll have the higher tech, and it is a Dark Shrine. I'm behind. So Primelot, as he takes a moment to realize the situation, which hopefully he does, he might think about, okay, how does he come back? Well, and, of course, tech advantage would be the case.
I find the Dark Shrine really interesting for a couple of different reasons. On one hand, you still got these two oracles that have been going in and out for kills, right? 7 on one, 8 on the other. They have been getting slow but sure probe kills. Bring those bad boys back, you've got Revelation for detection, you don't have to rush out an observer. I don't think the Dark Shrine ends up doing that much. And for Saki too, I really think this is intended for Dark Templar a lot less than it is for Archons. Because he hasn't got to mine off the second base for so long in this game, because his probe count's been behind, he just doesn't really have the money to sustain going for 5 Archons right now.
Yeah, and he's kind of used that gas bank he was originally with, because he was just warping in Stalkers, so it is going to be just 1, maybe 2 Dark Templars. Unfortunately, the proxy pylon he was probably hoping to use is gone now.
Yeah, he placed another one down. It'll be slow warp-ins, but it's still warp-ins across the map. Faster than warping at home and walking.
Yeah. Prima loses one of the oracles to the Stalkers, didn't realize that they were there. He never used his proxy pylon, just focusing too much, and then, of course, the lag-out screen. But that is still there. Saki pushed out. He could use it.
I don't know that there's really opportunity for him to use it with how much he was having. Yeah, like maybe within the last minute there's a little bit of wiggle room, but regardless, this observer is out and that Dark Templar combo won't work. Big investment out of Socket and got nothing for it.
Basically game.
Shboom! My god! Shboom! 33 years of resubbing. Woo-hoo! 33 OP. 33, the age of what I'm assuming Shboom is. He's actually an old sorry. Love you, Shboom.
Why do you assume that's his age?
I don't know, I'm just calling him old.
Oh, okay. I was like, I don't know if it's like some joke. He's always known he's older.
You used to play Counter-Strike with Shboom and Dr. Awesome and all those guys. It was actually pretty fun, good times.
Zella
Sam. Trying to remember who else was playing with us back then. Queen Green Tea. Haven't seen her in a while. Hope she's doing well.
Wow, that's amazing.
The nostalgia, right? A bit of a desperate plea, but an interesting one. Because let's assume for a moment Primelot has the same problem Zake did, right? Where maybe the defenses are too good. I don't think this will be the case, but let's say maybe it is. Overcharges are too scary. The unknowingness of the DTs just won't let him push in. Zake would eventually starve out on two bases, but with this one kind of hidden to the side, he has the potential to keep going in this game. But again, everything has been going so poorly for him up to this point, I don't think a Ninja Third is going to save him. It is just certainly cool that it has the potential to. Oh, is this probe rallied over here? No way. No, it's not. Okay. It's just running for the time being. No, wait, is it? I don't see an indicator where it's clicked to.
A DT killing a probe over here would still be really suspicious. It's not even going to do that. It is going to look for...
How does he... Oh my god, the star sends out a Primelot.
Well, again,
unless he was just putting his own proxy down? Oh, here's where it was clicked, by the Christmas tree.
Amazing, you didn't see it. Okay. Well, I was going to excuse him too, because it's like one of the things, like, okay, he tried a dark shrine. What else can he do to try and get back in this game? The hidden base would have been one of them. So either a hidden base or something like faster than disruptors.
This is...
I like the disruptors more than like hidden base, but both are Hail Marys, I think.
By the way, if that pro wasn't like over here to try and be sneaky and he just straight up scouted the base, that's when you start screaming like map hacks, right? You're just like, no way, man. No bloody way.
Yeah.
Regardless, I do agree with your point. Disruptors, I think, are the best option to get back in the game. Disruptors are perhaps the best part of PvP if your control is good enough to win games when you're behind. And they certainly bring that power. But that being said, Primal has shown not a lack of anything. Like, he's not been sloppy with the way his stalkers were. Realizing when attacks were bad, he'd pull away. The only mistake I'd really point out is like, oh my god, he lost an oracle to the stalkers. And that really isn't saying much. So I think that as long as he's on top of his game with blinks and he doesn't waste it, taking out the disruptors won't be too difficult. In fact, he sees that and he just blinks away.
It is interesting to see him go for Resident Glaives still, just because if they are able to get up to four or five disruptors, I do think that disruptor play trumps mass adept play, provided that their shots aren't totally terrible. But I guess if he's attacking before that number is high enough, if it's only going to be three disruptors, then I suppose it's fine. He'll probably be able to dodge him out well enough.
So I didn't even realize Primal had accrued like 30 or about 29 worker kills this game.
Yeah, adds really, up.
Yeah, just killing it here, literally. Nice shot on the disruptor, no chance for that to get away. Even losing a couple sockets for it, it's totally worth it because the disruptor is such a big, powerful, like,
and
game-changing unit.
That shot, so it's on cooldown now.
Well, he killed the one that shot.
No, the other one shot too.
Did it? I don't
There's
see
something
that on cooldown.
Exploded like orange in the middle.
Yeah, the one that got killed.
Oh, I guess it changed direction, so it looked weird. I thought I was going to the left and actually went like bottom left. Well,
maybe I clicked on the cooldown after it was up. Maybe it was just crazy. I don't know. Either way, it picks off another disruptor, blinks out of there, and Primelot just really he's coming to like a surgeon with these precision hits and just taking Sake apart one little bit at a time. He's gonna get top of the he's gonna let the adepts take care of the disruptors, and they will get those shots off. Oh, he does lose the adepts for it, but he's still got more than enough stalkers, more than enough immortals, even an Archon on that front line. Guardian Shield gonna pop up to reduce a lot of damage. Warp Prism trying to get some more adepts on the backside. Sake, he picked it off, but it's still not gonna be enough. Primelot coming through with a force to be unstopped, and looks like he will take this series 2-1.
Yep, that is it for Sake. Oh, nice little sort of shot there at the end, but yeah, just imagine if he had all of the soldiers alive and well, if the Sockers hadn't picked him off.
Yeah.
The same adept shot could have gone down and then some, and he would have even upped the army supply. Now he's lost more probes, and while yes, he still has that hidden base, and it's not been scouted despite a probe being right there. It still wouldn't be enough, I think, even if they traded armies.
Yeah, his remax, his income, everything's gonna be better for... Like, Primelot's good enough to keep going with this. He doesn't have to stop and pause. But speaking of a pause, quick shout-outs to Cot Life! 7 months! He says measly 7 years. Now, the disruptor shots could clean up this army. And let's say Sake, he actually cleans up all the army that's in his base right now. I still think he's lost this game, and for a lot of different reasons, but this base is really what's keeping him alive. This is the IV line, and Primelot has no idea. If you built a pylon here, he would have absolute control over the game. Right now, it's still questionable because... Ooh, nice feedback on that Oracle. It's questionable because Sake's losing out on mining that is not game-breaking to him. But really, this game is over, guys. I really want to just stress that. So should two Stargates come down, I feel like you could lose this army, and you could lose the next army to the Disruptors, and Sake still wouldn't be able to push through Primelot's ability to produce. I mean, the income is literally half. That means Sake literally has half the potential units available at any point in this game that Primelot does.
Because Primelot's probably thinking, like, really, why hasn't he left? Which is...
I love, by the way, that War Prism had nothing to threaten it, but he brought it back. That should really be an indicator that these two Stargates following up are going to be baller. There's just nothing to shoot them. One Archon, that's it.
Oh, they have to chance too. Huh. Interesting. I guess Primelot just keeping all of his army back so that wouldn't happen.
A little bit spooky. He's going to lose another big hit. Not good on these engagements, but still.
Yeah.
Credit goes where it's due. Sake doing a huge, hugely good job defending. But as pointed out, it will perhaps still not matter in the end. The three immortals just truck through everything. GG finally gets called, and ladies and gentlemen, Primelot, he takes the series 2-1. A very scrappy PvP finish. That was like, they're both heading towards the finish line. They're both exhausted from the race and just like crawling over each other together.
Yeah, a little bit.
Zaki like grabbing at the ankles. Get back here.
He'll face a Hero Marine next, so.
Yeah, I'm unsure whether that gets played today or not. We, however, are supposed to be doing TLO versus Gung Fu Banda next, from what I understand. So stick around, folks. We should have some pretty good games coming up when we're back. See you soon.